Architecture CodeX. If you want to see more, like, comment, share, and most importantly, subscribe.
At a time in the United States when if you said the word Transamerica, people would only think about the insurance company, the corporation announced that they would build a brand new headquarter tower practically across the street from their original building. The building referred to as the Pyramid was designed by Willaim Pereira and at 49 stories with a spire reaching 845 feet, it would be the tallest building west of the Mississippi until 2018. But this being San Francisco, not everyone embraced the idea. To get an authentic San Franciscan reaction, we're going to classmate and fellow architect and author, Jeffrey Lousteau. Jeffrey's compelling and incredibly well-researched novel, All We Have to Believe In, captures the soul of the city in the earliest part of the 20th century.
Thanks, Michael. You know, if the Transamerica Pyramid has taken on iconic status looming over San Francisco's skyline for the past half century, doesn't mean it's necessarily beloved by native San Franciscans. We may be known for our tolerance, but the pyramid's taken some time to get used to. We love our Victorians, our gaudy painted ladies, as they're called, but when it came to civic and business buildings, we've tended to go for more dignified and stately architecture. I remember getting dressed up and going to the Golden Gate Theater with my family in the summer of 1968 to see 2001 A Space Odyssey, and coming out of the theater watching people shaking their heads in disbelief. Well, that was similar a year later when, after we've landed on the moon, Willaim Pereira, the architect, unveiled his design for the Transamerica Pyramid. It just didn't sit well, this look at me building. Protests erupted. Stow the Shaft was the moniker given to the protests. I share this picture here of a lady sharing triangular pyramid-shaped cookies with folks as part of her protest against the building. You'll notice her white gloves, a real native San Franciscan. I think much of the negative reaction to the pyramid was in what was lost. A Montgomery block was its name, four-story office building on the corner of Montgomery and Columbus Avenue. That it stood there for over a century, dating back to the days of the Barbary Coast. A four-story rambling office block built on a raft of redwood logs. It was really one of the original business buildings in San Francisco, and in the course of a century, it became kind of a bohemian beehive for artists and writers. Writers such as Mark Twain, Ambrose Bierce, Jack London, painters like Diego Rivera, Maynard Dixon, photographer Dorothea Lange. This was a special building in San Francisco lore. It became known affectionately as the Monkey Block. Brought a lot of life and vitality to the city's artistic community. Much like Penn Station in New York, the destruction of this building would end up spurring the historic preservation movement, which fortunately has saved many beautiful buildings around the country in the 50 years since. But the Transamerica Pyramid became a reality in 1972, 48 stories, the tallest skyscraper west of the Mississippi. Thereafter, our beloved Herb Kane of the San Francisco Chronicle, his byline featured this cartoon of the skyline, which pretty much summed up the feelings of San Franciscans chafing at the presence of this sort of space-age phallic symbol on our skyline. Back to you, Michael.
Thanks, Jeff. Damn, he kept all his hair. The pyramid design immediately caught the public's attention, as it is an appropriate one, touted as the most practical way to build tall in earthquake-prone California. Its reference to ancient Egyptian architecture was also appropriate, as their governing architectural philosophy was based on ma'at, balance and order, and their vertical forms tapered inward for greater stability, the obelisks, the pylons, and of course, the pyramids. Earthquake and wind are both lateral stresses attacking from the side, whereas most buildings are simply designed to carry their load to the ground. Earthquakes move the land from side to side, and so a tall structure can be thrown off balance as the base is moving in one direction while the middle and the top are resisting the movement. Then, as the base moves back, the middle is moving in the direction of the first lateral thrust, and so on, until the building has a wave rippling up from the base to the top. When the upper portions of the building overhang the center of gravity, they will give in to that constant force of gravity, crack, and collapse. But a pyramid shape, a five-sided form composed of four equilateral triangles on a square base, tapers to the top, keeping the center of gravity low. So if the wave, moving vertically through the building, cannot move the center of gravity outside the breadth of the base, the building can resist earthquake forces. There are other ways to do this, mostly with mass dampers on top, which we have seen since New York City's Citicorp building, and all the super talls since. But Pereira's pyramid predates that technology. The Transamerica Pyramid is built into a section of town that was once the bay. It is set on piles that go 52 feet deep into the mud that support a concrete slab 9 feet deep as part of the mat foundation. At the base, the building exposes the cross-truss system that resists the large horizontal shear forces a building could experience during a major quake. Four interior truss systems go up to the 17th floor, with two interior frames continuing up to the 45th floor. The pyramid survived the 7.1 Richter scale Loma Prieta earthquake in 1989, which elsewhere killed 63 people, injured almost 3,800, and did $6 billion worth of damage in the Bay Area. Like a lot of great architecture, it was derided when it was first built, but it has since become a proud symbol of San Francisco, at least to outsiders, perhaps second only to the historic cable cars and the majestic Golden Gate Bridge. Subsequently, Transamerica Corporation has moved to Baltimore, Maryland, but the pyramid remains in their logo. Like many iconic buildings built by corporations at their apex, it was sold to a real estate company who is performing a 50-year major facelift as part of their goal to revitalize the downtown financial district. The $400 million renovation will keep the outside the same, but the inside will feature all sorts of new amenities necessary for Class A corporate real estate. And the pyramid, therefore, is expected to continue on for many more decades, as dignified as before. Warning, this next section contains immature subject matter. Viewer discretion is advised. Recently, the building was replaced as the tallest building in San Francisco by Caesar Pele's 61-story tall Salesforce Tower. This turgid building was erected in 2018 and joins a series of buildings around the world that attest to man's ever-rising aspirations, although they look like they are compensating for a city's otherwise flaccid skyline.
It was built to match the dictates of the developer,
Hines' interests, and Salesforce simply became their biggest tenant. Such buildings offer stiff competition for skyscrapers that already arouse strong feelings about their symbolic meaning. But it is a fallacy to say that the architects have been jailed for crimes against good taste. Even though the Salesforce Tower thrusts out of the ground, there is sufficient open space that circumscribes the building, allowing you to appreciate it in all its tapered glory. The curtain wall skin of the building uses a brisk soleil to deflect sunlight. The site is located near the Transbay Transit Center, meaning there is plenty of access. As one of Caesar Pele's last buildings in a long, distinguished career, it allowed him to go out with a bang. We now resume our normal video content. Transamerica engaged Los Angeles architect Willaim Pereira with the mission to build a tower that allowed plenty of light to get to the street. Pereira's pyramid form does that, in addition to its inherent seismic advantages. Pereira's pyramid is much steeper than the ones at Giza and has two shafts, often called the shoulders, that defy the form so the elevators can travel straight up. Some say that while the design reaches deep into history, it was just as influenced by Pereira's futurist inclinations as seen in other buildings, such as the Pacific Life Building in Newport Beach, the Howard Johnson Plaza Hotel at Disneyland in Anaheim, the Theodore Geisel, Dr. Seuss, Library in San Diego, or the Baghdad International Airport. Pereira's firms collectively produced over 400 major buildings across the world, so we are likely to run across him again in future videos. I really like the design of the Transamerica Pyramid, but given the logic of its shape, its inherent seismic qualities, its ability to allow light to get to the street, and its innate beauty, I'm surprised it has not been copied. Both via West 57th Street, Architecture Codex video number 17, and North Korea's 105-story tall Rugyong Hotel are not really pyramids and fundamentally different buildings. I don't know if the lack of imitation is because of mass stampers and how that technology has changed how we build tall. Or perhaps architects are hesitant to copy the building because it would be so obvious they were copying the Transamerica Pyramid. But I think it must be the latter, as the former has never stopped developers and architects from copying other great buildings. Still, for people like me who admire the building, we are happy that the building has never been copied. Otherwise, the skyline of San Francisco would begin to resemble a bed of nails. I'm Michael Molinelli, and this is Architecture Codex.